because now is also a very timely moment to discuss the future of Europe. I mean, you can always, of course, discuss the future of Europe. Tomorrow is always future. But at the moment, we are in a particularly interesting and difficult, and I'd say challenging time for the European Union. The Brexit that has already been mentioned by a couple of speakers has really been a singular moment that we have seen in the European Union. So far, the future of Europe was always one of large agenda for an integration, and then all of a sudden, basically, a country says, no, guys, we don't want to have anything to do with you, we do our own thing. And while I think that maybe wasn't the smartest decision ever, it's a decision that we have to respect, that we have to deal with, and we also have to look at what lessons can we learn from that, and what do we have to change in Europe so that the European Union is such an attractive project, not just because it's shiny, but because actually has a real value to offer. And I think there is a lot of things that Europe has always had to offer. The European Union is, after all, a project for peace. It's a project for overcoming borders and overcoming nationalism. It's a project for prosperity. It's an idea about building a better future together. And I myself from East Germany, and we were very lucky that the rest of the European Union allowed us to join basically one thing to the other, forget about any criteria. I'm living in my hometown, it's at the Polish-German border, and it was impossible almost to cross this border at certain points in history. So we've seen how through the enlargement of the European Union towards peace and with the Schengen area, how a border that once completely divided the town is now basically not anymore obstacle. It's just a pretty river flowing through the middle of town. And for me, this really is the whole idea of Europe, the whole idea of the European Union. Overcoming borders, working together, creating peace, and creating a better future for all of us together. But we have to acknowledge, of course, that this promise is not kept yet. In part, is not kept anymore. I mean, I don't have to tell you that the promise of prosperity sounds a bit odd here when you have so many people who are becoming poorer and poorer through policies that are not just for you, that are very much member state, but are still. But Europe has become the synonym for austerity. When we look at European Union where borders are being re-erected, where we have fences being built, borders being closed, when we have nationalist forces that are gaining more and more support, then it's very clear that those promises, they're not fulfilled, and a lot of people don't see anymore such promises as being realistic or achievable, or maybe even as desirable in the case of overcoming. So indeed, we have a very peculiar situation, a very challenging time for the European Union. And I think there is a lot of reasons for why that is at the moment. I think the whole idea about prosperity and also equality has been kind of lost on the way by putting one country against the other, by a lack of solidarity between member states. Because people, well, not people so much, but governments always look rather at their short-term national interest, and usually it's then them who define that and want to know the largest global people define what actually is the national, which I think is a very interesting question. It's been coming about through a constant bashing of European institutions, but also European positions. It's a typical thing, you know. They have the heads of state gathering together, they decide about things. It's behind closed doors, they don't know anything, and afterwards, you know, ministers like to say they go home and say, I achieved this great thing, so it was after something good, or it was something bad, and you say, no, I don't have anything to do with that, it was the others who decided that. So through that, you have a constant feeling of the EU being the scapegoat for everything bad around, and everything good had nothing to do with Brussels. This is also a problem of constant scapegoating, but partly also an issue of transparency, which is why we as the European Parliament were super transparent. You can watch online any meeting that we have, the councils will need to be in our stores. Ministers and heads of state, we don't know what they're doing, you know. If we're lucky, we have an agenda, but we don't really know what's happening there, who proposed what, which country supported what, but that would be actually really important to know for people to really also be able to make their electoral choices based on the positions their governments have been taking or would propose to take in the European Union. Another problem, I think, is that while the European Union is often seen as a token of globalization, like, you know, as a piece that exemplifies that, we don't have yet created an answer to the challenge of globalization and to the many problems that brings about, especially for employees. You know, what does it mean for the workforce? What does it mean for normal people in this globalization? And we haven't yet come to an idea of how to manage that properly. For too long, it was seen like, you know, just let's have free trade and somehow it's going to trickle down everybody's going to have a piece of the cake, but that's not the case. And we're having winners, very few, and we're having a lot of losers, and we're not having any proper answers to that. And another problem is, I think, that while decision-making has been becoming more and more European, so to say, a lot of the debate has remained national. It's a, you know, we have a very separate debate, for example, in Germany about Greek debt than we have in Greece, or for example, in Spain. We have a very different debate on migration in Poland and in France. And we know very little about each other's debates. We know very little about each other's concerns. We only practically get what, you know, the own national discourse says. We also don't have heads of state, for example, having to go to other national parliaments to justify a decision that they have taken, which would affect also the citizens of that country, and not only the citizens of the country where the head of state. So a lot of problems have led to the situation that we're currently in. But of course, now we can all sit together and say, life's tough, things are horrible, well, what can we do? We're just going to continue finding things horrible. But I think it's too cheap to just sit around and complain because we can all do that. But the question is, now what do we do now? What do we do about Europe? Do we want to do something about Europe? And I do think, well, I personally want to, because I still think that those promises that the European Union has made, that the idea is of Europe, they're still absolutely relevant. They're now probably more relevant than ever before. Let's just look at globalization. I mean, how is one country, one member state, going to deal with globalization on their own? With multinational enterprises that move from one country to the other, with all of the job losses in one area and the job gains in other areas that come about with that. It needs a European cooperation with that. What are we going to do, for example, about tax injustices in one country alone, you know, where one big company just goes to the country with the best tax rates for it? We need to have a European cooperation in order to create that tax justice. But also for social justice. Right now, people basically have the choice of emigrating somewhere else, but that's, I mean, why we are all in favor of moving around and spending time elsewhere. It shouldn't be forced on people that they have to move around. But that also means we have to create a European cooperation on that. Because it's also, I think, an illusion to have one European currency without having a proper European economic policy and also social policy. That has to go along with each other. Or if we look at climate change, it's a huge, huge problem. And there's not one country alone that can, you know, deal with the problem and solve the climate change. No, that has to be us, all of us together. Or also environmental issues. And I really argue that environmental issues are more than not a social issue as well. Because it's still the poorest people who live in those areas with the biggest air pollution, for example. You know, the rich people that can live in the hilly hillsides, in the green hillsides, they can go to an organic food market without any pesticides, whatever, and have their really happy life. But what about the people who don't have the need? Me in environmental justice is very much about social justice and the other way around. But the environment doesn't stop at the border. You can have very nice, cleaning up rivers, and it looks very nice, but if it goes to the next country, they have a different policy, and the rivers are going to be dirty. So environmental policy is probably the area where it's most obvious that you also need to have a European legislation. There's so many reasons, very urgent problems, very urgent areas of concern where we need to work together. For that, we do need the European Union. And I really believe that if we wouldn't have it at the moment, we would have to absolutely amend it. Because how else are we going to deal with all these problems? We have the tools at our hand, the European Union, which is certainly not perfect for me, just tool-wise, you know? All the problems of lack of transparency in the councils, for example, the issues of not having European public sphere, that's obviously there, that's problems that are going to, you know, make it harder for us to get the policies right. But at least we have, for example, we have a European Parliament that will publicly debate all sorts of issues. We have an attempt, and I think a lot of newspapers and TV channels have been met, it's much better at also presenting European issues and not just society saying, you know, across this society something, you don't really know how to set it up. So we have the tools in our hands, however imperfect they may be. So we need to use the tools in order to change the policies, because we really have a policy problem. The austerity policies, for example, is the wrong policy. A policy that only looks at free trade for everyone, about everything, is the wrong policy. A migration policy that is about closing borders is the wrong policy. So it's not the tools that are the problem, so it's the wrong policy. But I believe that actually we have a chance, and we have also a duty to change those policies for a better life for all people in Europe. And I think it's possible to do that. But what we need to do in order to get to that point is that we need to have our direction here. We need to know where we want to go with this European Union. Which direction should it be? Do we want to have a Europe that is, you know, just looking everyone at their own interests, or do we look at the whole big thing? Do we want to have a Europe that is just supporting the companies, or do we want to have a Europe that is more socially just? I'm presenting it to not just a little bias, but just to know in which direction I think the Europe should the European Union should go to. I think we should do everything we can to move the European Union to a direction of being an open continent without closing our borders off. A fair Europe as well, being fair to other countries, other people in other countries, but also being fair to the people in our own continent. A Europe of solidarity, in a way it's not just about short-term interests, and now we have to be solidarity with me because I want something, but tomorrow you want something, I'm not going to show you solidarity. A social Europe, I think that's a big pillar that's currently almost completely missing from the agenda of the European Union. A greener, environmentally friendly Europe, a Europe that is also at the forefront of peace and stability, of human rights, because that is unfortunately often getting lost and getting basically dusted off once and again. So once we have this direction there, we also need to not just say, okay, what do we want, a green, a social, a fair, whatever, you know, that's nice, but we also need to say, how we want to do that actually. What are the concrete proposals for each and every one of those issues? How do we want to go ahead about the social group? Because it's a nice slogan, but we also need to decide how we want to actually implement that. How do we want to create an environment to be just and you know, how do we want to make sure that it's fair to the inside and outside? How do we imagine an immigration and refugee policy that actually respects human rights and environment? And I mean, we as Greenwood, we're working on all of those issues, but I mean, we're not the only ones with ideas about it. There's other people who have ideas about different policy proposals, about concrete things that we want to do. And with those concrete things, we can also convince other people. You know, we have been paying in short 4 months of
conflict, we want to build that. Just give those of this balloon in there.
Exactly. What's your proposal, how you want to put that into practice that I think can really.
Για συνασπισμούς και συμμαχίες πρέπει να βρούμε παντού φορείς.
Well, fund alone in the battle and full our invention with 53 MEPs out of 721 in the But I think what allies actually exist is inside parliament, where we have corporations with different groups. But we also have allies outside of parliament, because anyway, I think it's very important to have this outside pressure to make majorities move in parliament, and that's how we move in parliament. And those allies exist in different NGOs and in civil society, sometimes organized, sometimes not so organized. Sometimes we work together with people on one issue, but maybe not so much on the other issue. Those allies exist, and I think we should go out and find them, and always have our feet in the grassroots, so to say, in order to make sure we understand where those allies are, and we don't overlook them, and that we take care of involving them, even though that might be sometimes quite important. Those allies are absolutely important for building this country, and I think that's also that's also been shown by the cooperation that we have here in Greece. But I do think that even though this is a pretty tough thing to do, because we of course do think, for example, one specific proposal might not fit to one or the other one, but I think it's still important to have a clear where you want to go and what are your steps towards it. Because sometimes you might have to divert your steps. There will be obstacles. You won't find enough allies, for example, in the council. But if you have a clear where you want to go, you can take diversions. You might have to say, okay, you have to take slower steps. If you know where you want to go, you can also take diversions. And you will not lose your point. But this European Union also really needs to be built. I think it really needs to be built now, because as I mentioned, the far right is growing. It's growing rapidly and urgently. We have the French elections coming up, for example, and we don't really want to think about that. But that's not the only big elections that we have coming up, and we have not the only strong far right. You see that in so many other European member states, pretty much in all of them. And it has to be done fast, but it also has to be done in an inclusive way, and it takes a long people's hope. Because I do think that we have answers to give, and I do think that the European Union is relevant for giving these answers, not just relevant, absolutely vital, we can't do that without them. But we need to get the policies right. We need to get the policies right with very concrete proposals, having direction here, but not this debate, and making sure that we talk with and communicate with one voice together, strong together, with a clear direction, but also in a way that is understandable, that it takes among people, and that we're open for allies. And it, of course, needs us, all of us in this room, to do it together. Don't wait for someone, you know, big guys or beautiful voices to come along and say, all of us, that's not going to happen, but we all have to find our own horses and our own battle gear in order to make this happen. But if we really want to do it and we have a clear picture of where to go, then I'm absolutely sure that we can achieve it together. Thank you so much.